What is going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Krash Course Metal Show. I'm your host, Trevor Krash Knight, and we got with us another week, another episode, and another appearance from Chris Elliot from 86 Bullets. What's up, brother?
Hey, how you doing,
Krash? Good, man. All right, so we're going to be bringing you guys here in this episode again, another all-killer, no-filler album in the metal scene here. So, Chris, I'm going to throw it to you here first. What is this week's pick for you?
Okay, for this edition, I have picked a surprise, Black Sabbath's Technical Ecstasy, which probably wouldn't appear on too many people's list of all killer, no filler. But I love this album. I think it's great. I think it's, well, they had a, Sabbath had a lot of really good albums, obviously. And I could pick several that I think are pretty much perfect.
Right.
This does not get a lot of love at all from critics. The band even doesn't like it for the most part. I just cannot find why people don't like it that much. I mean, I can kind of see why in the sense that it's very diverse. I mean, it's not all heavy. It's got some, definitely some segues into more progressive type of songs. They got some real slow ballady type of things on here, but more dark and moody.
Mm-hmm.
If I go down the track list, I'll kind of sketch it out. Well, first of all, this album was released in September of 1976, and it was during their, probably the peak or close to it, of their drug use. So they were all pretty coked out and messed up really bad, which was kind of a lot of bands were in that realm at that time, especially.
Yeah.
So the band was starting to fight and not get along. It came right on the heels of a really, really strong album called Sabotage, which arguably is their best or one of their best. It's generally considered up there.
Uh-huh.
This album, first of all, the artwork is just nuts. You either love it or you hate it. I've seen this on the list of the worst album covers ever.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. I think it's really clever. It's you know, it's two robots kind of doing the thing. You know, more like, right? Technical Ecstasy? I mean, come on. It's,
yeah.
Nuts.
I mean, craziness. It's certainly nothing hateful, I would say, on there. Nothing.
There's the back. A little, okay, little, yeah, splatter, like, on the wall from that robot.
Yeah, there you go. That, yeah, and yeah, it has the drawings of the band members there, kind of. I like that.
Yeah, it has some weird drawings. That was actually in the, this box set is amazing too. It's got all kinds of remix of the album, a live album. What's a double record set? It's got the original program from that tour, and those art, okay, that artwork is in there with the band members, like, all looking strange and stuff like that. So it was like, you know, it was a really crazy time for art and music and everything. You know, the bands were really experimenting with things. This is very experimental, as I mentioned before. Going down the track list, I'll just kind of rattle them off. Backstreet Kids just, uh-huh, starts out heavy, good song. It's not like, I don't think it's recorded the best of some of their stuff, but again, they were doing a lot of coke, and so was the engineer, and, you know,
right,
it's kind of, you had that happen during, especially this time period. You Won't Change Me. It's just, it's kind of proggy. It's weird. It starts out slow. It's heavy. It's kind of got everything in it. It's all right. It's a ballad sung by Bill Ward because apparently Ozzy didn't want to sing it. Pretty sure that's the song. There were a couple that Bill Ward ended up singing because Ozzy refused to sing them. But it's, I think it's a good song. It's way different from First Sabbath, but in its own right, I think it's pretty good. I think it might have been a single from that album too. I don't know. Gypsy is the final song in side one. That's a heavy track, really good, cool lyrics. I believe they played that in later days with the Aussie reunion. It was one of the few that they played. Well, they played a couple from this record. Actually, might have been up to three songs. So, you know, they hated the album, but they didn't, you know, I mean, these songs were still played even live. Then you got All Moving Parts Stand Still, which I think is a really cool song. It's quirky, it's different. There's actually a really wild version on this box set where they have like harmonica and just weird piano arrangements, stuff like that. It's actually really cool. But on here, it's more stripped down, and it's got some keyboards on it, but it's, you know, pretty guitar driven. Rock and Roll Doctor, just a rocking song. They, like I said, that's one they play live a lot. She's Gone, that's a ballad, but it's really dark. It's real sad, and you know, it's not your typical ballad. It's got strings arranged and all that, but I really like it. Good words, really sad, you know, like you can feel the emotion just throughout. And then the last song, and again, I try to gravitate toward very short albums because you get less chance to screw it up with a bad song, right? Dirty Women is the last one, and that's just a rocker. It's real grungy, grimy, I guess. Not grungy, but just, you know, I mean, it's got some, you know, cool lyrics, and I imagine that's a Geezer Butler thing. I believe he wrote pretty much all the lyrics, or most of the lyrics, back in the day. So that's it. You know, and I again, I don't, I think every song on here is strong. It's a real contradiction from what you get from the critics and that sort of thing. Like I said, even the band. It's kind of got the craziest artwork. You've got, you know, you got a white theme going on here. You know, Metallica did that actually. Their last two albums went with the white. Kind of different, right? Because, you know, a lot of these bands, you know, Black Sabbath, you know, several of their, you know, like Master of Reality was like black, you know, with purple on it, you know, you know, and their first album was like a haunted house with a witch in front of it, you know, so,
A lot of dark colors on their albums. And I agree with you. I was pretty surprised by this because I always heard a buddy of mine always said that he thought that this didn't deserve the hate that it gets either. And but I just never really got around to it. And then since we did this episode, I gave it a couple spins here. And it was pleasantly, now obviously it's not going to be anything like you said, the early or the classic stuff like Sabotage and before, but and there's still like good music here. I think Tony Iommi is still doing some good solos and such, doing good guitar work. It might just not be like that heavy metal that we are all used to from Black Sabbath, but still very good too. So it was certified gold in 1997, I believe. So it did take a little while for it just to reach gold. And it did hit number 51 when it came out on the Billboard charts. It you could say it had a little bit of accept or a little bit of success, but at the same time, considering their previous release and where Black Sabbath was at, not very good. So I'm with you though. For me though, I think I like the last three tracks the most. I kind of dug that. As far as like Rock and Roll Doctor, She's Gone, Dirty Women. I did dig that last piece. But at the same time, a lot of this stuff is very listenable. And I do like the change off of Ozzy as the vocalist because I'm not the biggest Ozzy guy, as everyone probably knows by now. Like, I like his stuff, but and with his vocals, though, I can take it in small doses. And then after that, it's like, okay, that's enough. So. But yeah, for me, I was pleasantly surprised with this. And definitely, I would say you more on the underrated side of things. But I mean, that's pretty much my whole scope of this. I think Tony still does good work on this. Still good songwriting, just more rock and roll. Even Black Sabbath was always bluesy, but I did definitely on some of these songs really pick up some more blues, but more on the rock side of things. But I enjoyed it, Chris. Very good stuff.
Yeah, I think it is. I think it's underrated. And the other thing too is that we tend to gravitate towards things that also mean something in our lives, where we were when we first heard something. And I remember this was one of the first albums I had it on a cassette. I think I borrowed it from my friend, and I remember it. I still have it somewhere, but it has Technical Ecstasy on one side and probably and something else on the other. I don't remember, but I used to just play it all the time. I thought it was great, but I was exposed to all the other Sabbath too, like the Paranoid, of course, and
Right.
Sabotage, Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath, all the classic stuff, Master Reality and so forth. That was all the Ozzy before Dio, which I really love that too, but in a different way.
Right.
So, again, I just listen to this and I just don't see where all the hate is, what it's for. Although I do know that there was a, some people didn't really like the direction they went in the more experimental realm. They started on Sabotage more or less. They got a little proggy, they weren't everything just, straight up riffs like Iron Man. And to me that stuff is basic sounding. You know what I mean?
Right.
It's good stuff, but I'd much rather listen to this than Paranoid now, just
Yeah.
because it's just got more ear candy, I guess is what it is. And they got really crazy on Never Say Die, which a lot of people would say was their worst album with Ozzy,
Yeah,
which is.
I did want to just mention that real quick. I would prefer to listen to this over Never Say Die. I am not a big fan of Never Say Die. I might like three tracks out of that whole album, and that's pushing it. So, but this was definitely a better listen. I feel for me, I enjoyed it a little bit more than, or way more than, Never Say Die.
Yeah, I like Never Say Die, but it gets really weird. I mean, they go into like jazz and stuff like that. I mean,
Right.
again, some of it, like if you take it for what it is and you don't think, okay, it's not Black Sabbath, then
Yeah.
you're like, okay, that's cool, and I think that's the trouble, especially when we had when we were younger or we had bands, you were there when the album came out and you were ready for. All right, this next album, it's going to be, they're going to be back to Master Reality. And then you get that, and you're like, what the heck? What is this? And now I wasn't in that because those albums were already out by the time I was getting into metal. It was probably, well, I'd actually, I think I got into Black Sabbath on the Heaven and Hell album. I
Okay.
believe it was Dio before I really got into the Ozzy stuff.
Right.
So I'd heard, Heaven and Hell was amazing. I couldn't take that off the record player. I got it in 1980, and I just kept, this is like the best thing I'd ever heard, and it still is. It's a
Oh, yeah.
that could say that's pretty all killer there too. But then I kind of went backwards in the catalog, and I was more accepting of things like Technical Ecstasy, Never Say Die, and things like that. It was way different, but I dug it. But then again, I, my tastes were, I got into jazz, classical, and all kinds of things. To me, I still do because it doesn't matter the genre as long as it's good and I like it. That's about all that counts. But I can see people that are into heavy rock and they get an album like that, and they're just kind of shocked in a
Exactly.
bad
Like, not
way. And
if
it's like,
they
what is
if
this?
you don't have an open musical mind, or like us, if you're just sticking to one genre, then yeah, you're probably gonna have a problem with this album. And but if you're open to different sound and stuff, then certainly this album is worth a listen to at least.
Yeah,
So
and I think technical is pretty much on the borderline, and I mean it's got enough heaviness in it really, but it does have its moments of, real experimental things, but I like that. I like when bands just change it up, I mean, not it, I mean, they could change it up and fall flat on their face if it was really crappy music.
You're
Well,
right.
I don't think it's crappy. I think this one's really good. So, yeah, so that's my pick for this.
All right. Nice. Yeah, definitely a good pick. Probably the most black sheepish pick of our series so far, even more than Rat Detonator. This might be might be a little bit more of a black sheep. So,
Be yeah,
all right.
maybe
So,
they're close, but yeah.
they're definitely the top two there. So, for my pick this week, I am going to be going with 1985's Sp "Spreading the Disease" by Anthrax. So this is the first one with Joey Belladonna on vocals, and for me, man, I always enjoyed this album. This was probably maybe the first Anthrax album I ever heard. I can't remember if it was this album or Persistence of Time is which album I had first, but I do enjoy both of them quite a bit. They're probably my two favorite Anthrax albums, but. Yeah, so for Spreading the Disease though, very good. I love the artwork too. I can't remember the guy's name that did the artwork, but he also did the artwork for Led Zeppelin's Physical Graffiti as well. I heard that, I read that on some website, and I'm guessing that's true, but I didn't do any cross examinations or anything. So we'll take that for what it is. But yeah, I mean, you got the single on here, "Madhouse." They did a music video for that as well. Good song, very good song. I like Joey's energy that he brings to this album. This is probably, I like the production on this first and foremost. Very does have a raw sounding, but it does. But everything's clear though as well. Nothing like you're in a. Recording in a trash can or anything like, or real echoey or anything like that. Very, very solid album. I know a lot of critics do praise this up, but I still think it's somewhat underrated. This is not the first two albums I would probably say Anthrax fans would put in their top two for the most part, because you always get Among the Living is probably number one from most fans. And maybe Persistence or even State of Euphoria and give or take. This might squeeze in with some people, but for me, easily number one or number two for me. So I just like the songwriting too. I don't think the Anthrax is a very hit and miss band for me. That's first and foremost. They're probably my least favorite of the thrash genre, just in general, and definitely the big four. But I think with this, I love the songwriting on here. Solars are good. Just the beats of these songs are very good. The Enemy, I love that. Armed and Dangerous, nice intro to that song. Even Medusa is. Medusa and Gung Ho are the last two tracks on this album, and you could probably argue that they're the weakest two of the album. So, I mean, but even still, they're still very listenable and very good. Stand or Fall, man, Lone Justice. I like the song, the story that it tells on that. I mean, it, and you open up the album with AIR, it just gets you pumping and going right away. So, for me, Chris, I mean, I know you're an Anthrax guy. I know you have a little bit of something to say. There you go.
No, I got the same exact one that you have, the CD version. Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really strong record. I do like Among the Living a bit better. I think there's a few places it maybe gets, not as like top-notch for me, kind of sort of in the middle, but
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, as far as a second album, a sophomore effort especially too, because we talked about that before,
Right.
is really strong. And you're right, it is one of those that is a seminal, you know, it is the critics generally, it is well regarded by fans and so I mean it is pretty well produced. They could have brought Frankie's bass up a little more, I thought, but
Right, yeah.
that was they were probably hazing him because he was wasn't he Frank Charlie's cousin, and they brought him
Yes.
in or nephew to take the other guy's place who quit or something. That's the other thing too. You got a shake up where you've got a new singer, and he actually Joey did do vocals on the EP Armed and Dangerous. Some of you can see that. This is Fistful of Metal, which was their first album with Neil Turbin on vocals. And then you had Armed and Dangerous, which is on here as well. And that was an EP, which was well, it's got like seven songs, but it's got some live stuff, and it's got a, like Armed and Dangerous is on here, which is on Spreading the Disease. So you have a little bit of crossover. So that was, I guess they were testing him out or something, but he's got a heck of a voice, man. I don't know if he can do some of the notes that he does on Spreading the Disease anymore. Going to see him live in about a week and a half, so which
Oh man, that's awesome.
but he's, you know, I mean, there's some of the notes were just, you know, amazing. His voice is super good. So yeah, he here's the first actually the first album I one of the first CDs I ever bought was this Attack of the Killer Bees. So when I first got into CDs, it came out in 91. It's actually got 12 tracks on it. It's supposedly an EP, but they say something like it's the like you know longest EP that's ever made. There it is. It says the longest EP ever. So anyway, but they were getting a little bit experimental in here. They were getting into like the rap stuff and all that. And, you know, I don't know. I think that might have polarized some fans, but back to Spreading the Disease, it's straight up metal. It's thrash. You know, the riffs are.
And that's one more thing I would like to say about that. This is probably their most non, because I don't want to say, because all their stuff is thrashy, but this is the least punky, maybe, of their releases, you think?
Well, yeah, I don't know that they got super. Well, you always had that Scott Ian influence, I guess. I mean, he was writing everything, right? All the rhythms, at least I can tell. But I didn't think I heard it that much on like the Among the Living State of Euphoria into that period. It seemed like after that they got a little more experimental with it, but no, it's definitely seems more straight up metal. You know, it's thrash metal. They were right there with Metallica and all them coming out, Megadeth. And they all just seemed to, well, I think Metallica was the first one out of the gate, right? In 83 with Kill 'Em All. You had,
I think
I
that was
think.
like technically the first album released. And like, wasn't Slayer
Yeah.
somebody just like a couple months behind, I
Oh,
believe?
yeah. Slayer was up there. You know, they were early too. Yeah. And then this one, I think. Fistful was 80. I think it's 84. I could be wrong about that, but
I think it is too. Let me can check here. Yeah, it says here 1984 for
yeah,
Fistful.
Armed and Dangerous was 85, I believe. Or I mean, Spreading the Disease. So
Correct.
yeah, so it was a really seminal period, and you know, you had a lot of really good music coming out. It was amazing stuff. But yeah.
And it didn't go gold or anything. It didn't do real. It did hit 113 in the top 200 billboards when it came out, but it never got certified, it looks like. So that's kind of surprising to me. But like you said, they kind of blew off the lid with the next album with Among the Living, and then they got all their fame from that. So, but yeah, very good. Obviously, guys, I mean, Among the Living is a classic as well. But for me, though, I gravitate towards Spreading the Disease more so than a lot of Anthrax's other stuff, and definitely more of an all killer, no filler album for me in my ranks. So, Chris, if you have anything else to say about these two albums, we can pretty much wrap up.
No, I mean, I agree with you. I think it's a great album, great choice. And again, my pick was a bit off the wall, but I think it definitely deserves some love and attention, right?
Yeah, it's certainly underrated. I'll go that far at least with you. You know, it's certainly underrated and deserves to get spun a couple more times from people that maybe never even heard of those two, Never Say Die or Technical Ecstasy, that era of Aussie Black Sabbath. So
Yeah,
I'm right there
it's
with you.
and there's a lot of subjectivity too. Like, what, you know, there are some albums that are supposed to be great that I just can't really get into. I'm like, really? And then there's ones that I think are great, and I see that they've got panned by the critics or the fans, and I'm like, that's a really good album. So
Right.
I think
Yeah.
at the end of the day, it comes down to your taste and what you like, and you know what inspires you, what you get off to. So.
That's the thing with music. No one's right with music. No matter what, no one is correct on their choices. So
Yeah.
it's quite a taste for everybody. So
Yeah,
certainly.
it's like I like vanilla ice cream, but you might not like vanilla. You might like chocolate. So, you know,
Well, we both love
it's like,
ice cream, so there you go. I mean, that's all
well,
that
there
matters.
you go. It's like with music. We love music, but some of it's a little different. So,
Yep, exactly.
but
So,
yeah, I
guys,
think we,
let us know, guys, in the comments, what you guys think this week. Do you guys like Spreading Disease a little bit more than Technical Ecstasy? Give us a little feedback. What you think of these two albums? So, like I said, guys, that pretty much wraps up. We want to thank you for watching Crash Course Metal Show. I'm Trevor Crash Knight. And Chris Elliott right there. Until next time, we will see you guys later.